Today we will have an interesting discussion on the future of computing. When we discuss about the future, we are asking our future colleagues or our future already existing colleagues, so the young colleagues newly appointed, on their view of computer science informatics, which is a broad topic, so they will not cover all the aspects of the future of computing, but their view, they will provide their view on this future.
Due to the low latency demands of applications, we have to bring data close to the users. And we have completely new challenges on how our data centers look like. What you can see here, it's not a submarine. It is an underwater data center. You can put data center underwater. You get cooling for free, plus the half of the world's population live in coastal areas. So you get low latency. This is also a data center produced by Huawei that you can put into the corner of your office so you have your data close to you. And I also dare to say that this is also a data center, Raspberry Pi. It's the first hot data center where you can do a very simple, but still you can do computation. So the next challenge that we have to cope with is the heterogeneity of data centers. There are no more big buildings somewhere. There will be everywhere around us in many different forms and flavors.
But what we have to also see that there is a huge gap between the efficiency between a human person and the machine. And we see is that these supercomputers operate at 200 kilowatts to 1 megawatt, you know, just for this competition, while our brain works at 20 watts. And that's the holy grail question of the whole brain-inspired computing paradigm. Can we achieve this kind of intelligence at an extremely low power budget, in the best case, close to a human brain? But on the other hand, if we can understand the brain very well, we can actually, you know, surpass the capabilities and improve it beyond the level. We stand today at the software-based implementations where we see heavily the use of GPUs and things like this. So one of my students has actually developed now this kind of stuff, really implementing the neurons and the GPUs and seeing that what are their power consumptions. The next step that the community is now pushing is approximate computing, which is a scalable effort computing kind of thing that our brain does, which means that if today you give an input to your computing machine, it always gives you the same output with the same efficiency. While your brain actually adapts, it optimizes continuously on the fly, and it doesn't need to do, you know, the processing with the same effort every time. Am I looking into recognizing each person in the room, or am I counting the number of people? There are two different types of processing happening.
So the goal of the research of my group is to make it possible from a technological perspective to retain our right to security and privacy in the digital society. Technically, this is achieved, or we work on that, following two research strands. On the one hand, we develop verification techniques that can formally and rigorously prove the intended security properties for the programs we use every day, such as web applications, mobile applications, the cryptographic protocols that are supposed to secure our internet communication. And on the other side, we develop cryptographic solutions to protect the privacy and security of users in online services like cloud services or upcoming technologies like blockchain. Quantum computers might become a reality in the near future, and should this happen, many of the cryptographic algorithms that we use today to secure our society are going to be completely broken. So we need fundamentally new cryptographic mechanisms, and this is an area called post-quantum cryptography that will become more and more important.
And in my research, it's logic, but automated logic, and this is the field that we call automated reasoning. And I want to convince you that basically automated reasoning is the right tool, or is the tool that is used in ensuring software reliability. Now, in all these cases, and in other software examples, if software errors happen, they are very costly. Actually, they cost the reputation of the company, but in actually even worse cases, they can even cost human lives. So the task of how I'm using automated reasoning, the task is, for software reliability, the task is that if you're given a software program, show that it has no errors. Now, this particular task is very similar if you look at a mathematical test book. Because this formulation is actually a theorem. It is the task of a theorem that mathematicians or students in our university have to prove. So the message in my research is, if you know already to prove theorems in math, then why don't we use math to prove theorems in computer science? And this is actually what we do. We use mathematics for proving the absence or the presence of a software bug. So what are non-classical logics and why are they useful? So we have seen already in Laura's talk that classical logic is great to reason about software errors, but it's also extremely good to talk about design, hardware design, or about mathematical statements. Actually, mathematical statements, so think about a lemma, a theorem, can be either true or false. However, this tertium non datur idea does not apply to all contexts. And actually, we might want to reason about statements that are true up to a certain degree. So for instance, having high fever or having strong pain. So in this case, we would reason instead using a logic within the family of so-called fuzzy logics. Let's say the long-term goal of this research would be to provide some logic-based languages for building sophisticated communicating systems which are correct and secure by design.